Fueron jornadas de reflexión, de discusión, y yo solamente quiero terminar diciendo, se ofrece ahora una nueva herramienta. Por supuesto, tendrá que irse depurando, mejorando, como manual. Pero, ¿qué es lo más importante? ¿El manual de cómo hacer la cosa o la cosa que se ha hecho con el manual? No es el manual lo más importante. Las leyes orgánicas o la legislación que establece, aún las bases constitucionales que da las facultades de fiscalización a los congresos, las leyes orgánicas que establecen la forma de organizarse para esa fiscalización, las comisiones, los comités, tanto de investigación como de contabilidad y revisión de cuenta, como los reglamentos y la forma en la que las directivas intentan favorecer o desfavorecer el trabajo de la fiscalización, son tareas que solo el que está en ese Parlamento, en ese Congreso, puede resolver. Pero ¿qué necesidad de resolverlo solo si hay buenas prácticas, si hay referencias, si hay manuales, si hay compañeras y compañeros, si hay colegas, si hay militantes de la misma causa? Ese es el propósito de este manual, esa es la necesidad de que los congresos fiscalicen las cuentas, fiscalicen a los ejecutivos, pero lo más importante, y con esto termino, es que de la fiscalización se deriven consecuencias. Que si la ley establece que quien ha cometido un delito, que quien ha cometido corrupción, que quien se ha distraído los recursos destinados a generar un bien para su propio beneficio, debe de haber sanciones. La impunidad es la que ha venido agotando las capacidades del Congreso o de los congresos. La impunidad es la que hace increíble o hace incrédulo al votante, al ciudadano, de que su diputado, su senador, su representante sirve de algo. Revisar las cuentas y exigir sus consecuencias es la función del Parlamento. Ojalá este manual que hoy se lanza, que viene apoyado también por un libro o varios libros, y que hay forma de consultar todo el trabajo previo, se ve enriquecido con su propia experiencia, con su aportación, y a través de los mecanismos de GOPAC, desde sus páginas de internet, desde los blogs y la forma en la que podemos mantenernos comunicados, se puede enriquecer. Yo espero que todos tengamos un taladro eléctrico y todos pongamos la clavija justa para tomar la corriente eléctrica de la sociedad. Muchas gracias.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Our third and final speaker is Dr. Ricardo Paliso. Dr. Paliso is a political scientist and a legislative studies specialist. After graduating from the University of Bologna in 1995, he received a graduate diploma in international affairs from the Bologna Center of the Polnitzi School of Advanced International Studies, and an MA and a PhD in political science from the Johns Hopkins University, Baltimore, USA. His studies have been published or translated into multiple languages. He works as a consultant on legislative affairs for the World Bank Institute. Dr. Paliso.
Thank you. It's great to be here, and it was great to be in Brussels 1 year ago when we held the study group. That was a very, very useful experience for us because we prepared some background work, we went to the meetings, we had the fortune to meet some parliamentarians from GOPAC who brought us back to reality and gave us a chance to transform abstract academic and unintelligible philosophical ideas into something more practical, and the result is this. So you will be able to judge by yourself where and to what extent we've been able to be useful. In my presentation, I would like to make three points. One concerns the importance of building oversight capacity. The second is how we can measure it and how we can assess it, because that's a big key component of our handbook and one of our books. And then I want to discuss some of the general findings that we present in greater detail in the book. The collaboration between WBI, the World Bank Institute, on the one hand, and GOPAC on the other hand, is based on a simple assumption, which is we are all against corruption. And so we thought we need to do some work together to understand what we can do to fight corruption, to curb corruption, to prevent corruption, because we know that corruption, however measured, is detrimental to development, is detrimental to growth, is detrimental to economic equality, is detrimental for the poorer segments and the weakest segments of society. And so we got together and we decided that we were going to do some joint work on what parliaments can do to fight corruption. And the project grew over time. And so while at the beginning we were hoping to be able to condense everything in a single volume, we ended up producing two books and two handbooks. In the other one, in addition to discussing what are the costs of corruption and what are the things, what are the steps that parliaments can take to fight corruption, for instance, passing campaign finance legislation, introducing anti-corruption legislation, setting up anti-corruption agencies, adopting codes of conduct, and so forth and so on. But in the other book, we didn't deal specifically and extensively with oversight, because we thought that the legislative oversight is such an important factor in curbing corruption that it deserved, that it was necessary to draft a separate monograph. So that's what we did. Why is oversight important? Why is building oversight capacity important? Because if you actually go outside and eventually get a copy, or if you already have a copy, you can see that towards the end of this handbook, we present a couple of graphs. Even if you're not the world's greatest statistician, the lesson that you can draw from these two graphs is very simple. Oversight capacity, it's important. And it's important because it has a direct effect on things that we all value, like political stability and the ability of systems of government to curb corruption. But at the same time, it has an indirect effect, and that is that it creates the condition for parliaments to perform their oversight function effectively. One of the key lessons that and Senator Cervantes said so before, that that we learned in the course of the study group in Brussels was that we know that some legislatures are better equipped than others to perform their oversight function. But sometimes, regardless of what's their oversight capacity, they do not perform as well as they could or as well as they should, while others that are less adequately equipped outperform them. And the reason was, or the lessons that we learned from parliamentarians and friends in GOPAC, was that some parliaments are more successful than others in performing oversight because they have the will, the political will, to fight corruption. And so they take their task, or this task, to their heart, and they're very effective. That said, if we have two parliaments that are equally committed to fighting against corruption, the one that has a wider mandate, more tools, is going to be more effective. And so this lesson appears very clearly from the data analysis we present in this book, and we think this is a very important lesson. The second point that we make in the book is that we present an index that we call the SPILO or SPILO, which stands for Stepinac-Pelizza Index of Legislative Oversight, that I think is very, very user-friendly and useful, because in a way anybody can take up these. This index that we present and check how well equipped its parliament, either parliament or her parliament, actually is to perform oversight. And so you can identify areas where you're strong, you can identify possible weaknesses, and you can actually forecast fairly well how effective your parliament is going to be in performing this oversight function. We devised this index for presidential systems, because we were asked to come up with solution and to think about and speculate or to think about how congresses or legislatures in presidential systems can perform and how well they can perform their oversight function. But this assessment tool, this diagnostic tool, can be applied even in parliamentary systems. So you can actually go back home and see where into, you know, your parliament has these features. And this will provide a very reliable indication of how well it's going to perform the oversight function. So we believe this is kind of useful, because anybody can see where how well the parliament is endowed and how and it can be improved. The third thing that we found in the book, and I think this is more interesting to me as a political scientist, but I think it could be relevant to all those parliamentarians and constitutional lawyers who live and work in a presidential system, is that our book challenges a little bit, and also the handbook challenges some of the received wisdom as to how well or how bad presidential systems really are. One of the things that political scientists and an international organization as well have believed for the last, for many years, since certainly from the mid-90s onward, was that the presidential systems are bad. That has been a traditional story for many, many years. Presidential systems were blamed for a variety of reasons. They were said to be less adequate to sustain democracy, and they were said to be more likely to be conducive to democratic breakdown. They were said to be not adequately equipped or that parliaments operating presidential systems were not adequately equipped to perform their oversight function, and they were also blamed for higher levels or higher rates of corruption, and so in the course of this fairly engaging research project, we actually found that the stories are slightly, or actually rather different from what the received wisdom was teaching us. For example, the first thing that we found is that it is not true that presidential countries that have a presidential form of government are more corrupt or are the most corrupt. The most corrupt countries, on average, are countries that have a semi-presidential form of government, a government modeled after the French one. The second lesson that we learn is that parliaments operating parliamentary systems are slightly better equipped than legislatures performing operating in presidential systems in terms of oversight capacity, but the difference between these two systems is not as big as once it was believed. For instance, what we found is that parliaments or legislatures in presidential systems are more active in ex ante oversight activities, whereas parliaments operating in parliamentary system are more active ex post. And also we found that parliaments operating in parliamentary systems are more equipped in terms of internal oversight tools, while parliaments operating in presidential systems have more external oversight tools. And the third difference was, and the third lessons that we learned from all this was that it is not very accurate to speak of parliaments operating in presidential systems in an aggregate way, in terms of averages, so to speak, because there are many differences. You know, within the countries that have a presidential form of government, and I hate to tell you, go back and check these two pictures at the end, but you can see that, you know, at the bottom of each of these two pictures, we have our index of oversight capacity. And you can see that it ranges and it varies dramatically. So these countries have the same form of government, but in some of them, parliament does not have much capacity to oversee the executive, while in other has an extensive such capacity. And that makes a considerable difference. And finally, the fourth lesson that we learned is that, contrary to what many political science colleagues have said, which is that presidentialism is bad for democracy, we found that actually the quality of democracy in presidential system is not that bad. And actually where it is more lacking, or where it could be better or should be better, is in semi-presidential systems. So to sum up a little bit, because I don't want to keep you here for longer than I should, in this handbook we try to be as practical as we can be. This handbook is designed to be helpful for parliamentarians. We highlight some key findings, we provide some practical tools, and very, very down-to-earth, as far as we can, advice. In addition to the handbook, we've produced longer manuscripts, two book manuscripts, where you can find a considerable amount of evidence that could not possibly be condensed in presented in the handbook. I'm told that GOPAC will be organizing and is willing to organize workshops and seminars and events around the planet. And the book version, or the longer version of this handbook, the book version of this manuscript, will be distributed there to participants. So if you want to get a copy of the book, and you don't want to buy it online, though it's available online for those of you who want to buy it, you can ask GOPAC to organize a workshop for you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Paliso. At this stage, I would like to open the floor for discussion. So if there are any questions or comments, we will take them now. We have one here. So we'll take you for first. We have three, sorry. Four. We have one. So it'll be one, two, three. To start, let's have one, two, three to start, and then we'll go further back. Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. My name is Dr. Boni Khalwale. I am an elected senator in the Republic of Kenya. APNEC. And a member of APNEC. First of all, may I thank the panelists for the good presentation. I have three little questions. As far as the fight against corruption is concerned in our republic, Kenya, we've done very well as a legislature. We have most of the anti-corruption laws in place. But now we have a special challenge, and I don't know what your experience is on this particular challenge. The first one is that we now have situations whereby the chief executive shields perpetrators of corruption, or in some instances provides outright protection to them to the extent that they ignore recommendations of parliament regarding the culprits who are members of his cabinet. How do you deal with that? The second one is that political party interests and ethnic interests within parliament normally affects the voting pattern when a decision is being taken by parliament on matters of corruption. What is your experience and how do you deal with it? The last point is You have said that you have resources at your disposal, which we can use to enhance our work. I would like you to clarify the procedure that we can use so as to access these resources to help us to be more empowered. Thank you very much.
Muchas gracias. Debo hacer un breve comentario para salir en mi pregunta. En primer lugar, quisiera decir que informar a las colegas que soy de Albania.
Can we have your name and where you're from?
Sí, yes. Soy de Albania, país de origen de Madre Teresa, quien no sabe dónde está. Y me llamo Namik Dokle, soy diputado hace 23 años de mi país. Claro que el tema que estamos discutiendo está muy, muy, muy importante. Por ejemplo, el señor presidente dijo que, en su discurso dijo que la corrupción en muchas ocasiones les roba a la gente hasta la vida. Es una verdadera tragedia. No sé cómo está esta situación en otros países, pero en mi país es muy, 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 muy problemática. En 20 años, solo por conflictos de intereses de propiedad, se han asesinado 8.200 personas. Quiere decir 400 cada año, quiere decir más que uno cada día. Y eso porque no funciona bien la justicia, no funcionan bien las leyes, no funciona bien la sociedad, etcétera, etcétera. Porque el funcionamiento legislativo de los parlamentos funciona más o menos bien. Pero el papel controladora de los parlamentos y parlamentarios creo que tiene muchas mancanzas. Así que quisiera preguntar a doctor Ricardo Pelizzo, mi vecino, porque Italia y Albania somos países vecinos, quisiera preguntar por una cosa. En mi país dicen que si alguien quiere salvar la montaña, debe ser más fuerte que la montaña. ¿Cómo puede ser el Parlamento más fuerte que la corrupción y los corruptos? Porque dicen que ahorita, en actualidad, se ha corruptido también la lucha contra la corrupción. ¿Y qué debemos hacer? ¿Cómo debemos realizar este papel controladora de los parlamentos? ¿Qué herramientas tenemos en mano de los parlamentarios para hacer esto? Porque me parece muy, muy importante lo que usted ha escrito en este manual, muy importante, que dice la función de vigilancia por parte de la sociedad civil, antes limitada, aumenta al romperse el monopolio del Estado sobre la responsabilidad de ejercer la fiscalización oficial únicamente a través del Ejecutivo. ¿Cómo podemos cambiar esta situación? Muchas gracias por todo que han plantado.
Thank you. We will now have the third.
Merci, madame. Merci, madame la présidente. Moi, de mon côté aussi, au nom de la délégation marocaine, je suis parlementaire du Maroc. Je voudrais féliciter toute l'équipe pour le travail qui a été fait. Un travail, il est vrai, un travail de fond. Compliqué. Et le plus compliqué, c'était de le traduire en outils pratiques et en manuels pratiques. C'était effectivement le plus difficile. Bon, un détail pratique également, je regrette qu'à l'entrée, on ne l'ait pas trouvé en arabe ni en français. Donc, j'ai pris un manuel quand même, mais bon, je pense que par la suite, il y en aura dans toutes les langues officielles du GOPAC. Également, j'aurais souhaité trouver le Maroc parmi les pays qui ont été analysés. Il est certain que le Maroc ne relève pas des régimes présidentiels. Mais le Maroc, à travers ses parlementaires, et vous l'avez dit tout à l'heure, je crois que c'est M. Jaffar qui l'a dit, professeur Jaffar, a fait preuve d'un engouement et d'une... On est totalement en phase avec le travail du GOPAC. On est totalement impliqué avec le travail du GOPAC. L'expérience marocaine, on aurait souhaité la voir.
I'm sorry, we're not getting the English translation.
I I would like to speak English, but my English is not so good. It's okay?
Okay.
C'est bon.
Thank you. You can go
ahead. I repeat from the first. Yes. Bon, okay. Donc, je disais, toutes les félicitations pour l'équipe. Pour toute l'équipe qui a travaillé. Non. Congratulations to all. To toute l'équipe qui a travaillé sur ce manuel. Un travail de fond et un travail compliqué. Mais la complexité est de rendre ce travail pratique, de le traduire en manuel pratique à la disposition de tous les parlementaires. En tant que parlementaire marocain, d'abord je regrette qu'on l'ait pas, comme j'ai dit tout à l'heure, qu'on ne l'ait pas trouvé à l'entrée dans la langue arabe ni dans la langue française. Je pense que ça va se faire par la suite, que la diffusion sera générale à travers l'internet, mais je regrette également que le Maroc ne figure pas dans l'étude comparative. Il est vrai que l'étude ne concerne que les régimes présidentiels, mais il y a quand même une expérience marocaine, il y a un engagement total du Parlement et des parlementaires marocains dans toute la mission du GOPAC. Il est également reconnu que l'expérience marocaine est une expérience d'un pays précurseur dans la région géographique sud de la Méditerranée. Et nous aurions souhaité pouvoir enrichir justement les parlements concernés par l'étude, par l'expérience marocaine, mais également profiter justement de cette analyse pratique et critique de ces expériences-là pour pouvoir également améliorer ce qui est à améliorer. C'est le seul point sur lequel je voulais intervenir. Je vous remercie encore une fois. Félicitations à toute l'équipe.
Thank you. Well, I just like to let you know that it is being translated into French at the moment. So it will be available in French. Thank you. So if any of our fellow panelists would like to start answering, we would.
Muchas gracias y muy breve. Empezaré por haciendo una reflexión sobre la intervención de Marruecos. Me parece que es muy afortunado que haya más trabajo que vida, de tal manera que pasaremos la vida haciendo el trabajo y lo que nos haya faltado de consideración para Marruecos, ojalá nos dé la vida para hacer ese trabajo. Estoy seguro que lo haremos. Las regiones, a través de GOPAC, se vienen integrando, vienen consolidándose, las buenas prácticas, la comunicación. Nuestra aspiración a ser una organización global no nos permite plantearnos límites ni por idiomas, ni por distancias. Ninguna circunstancia nos puede limitar si de veras queremos ser una organización global. Estaremos en todas las latitudes, haremos todo el trabajo que la vida nos alcance, y qué bueno que vamos a dedicar la vida a trabajar, si no, ¿a qué otra cosa? De tal manera que llegaremos a tener las traducciones y las inclusiones de regímenes presidenciales, parlamentarios, semiparlamentarios y lo que surja. Eso lo haremos, depende de nosotros. La pregunta de Albania es directamente a la sapiencia, la ilustración de nuestro colega y además tocayo, tiene desde el nombre, lo tiene ilustre, se llama Ricardo, igual que yo. Él responderá al tema de Albania, pero sí quiero referirme a algunos aspectos sobre el planteamiento del doctor en Kenia. ¿Qué pasa cuando el poder protege a los perpetradores de la corrupción? Simplemente se manifiesta la naturaleza misma de la corrupción. Ese es el mismo reto que desde el principio. ¿Por qué hay corrupción? Porque alguien desde una posición de poder se aprovecha de esa posición para enriquecerse o para beneficiarse. Si es el Ejecutivo o los mismos partidos políticos que los que militamos en partidos políticos, sabemos que lo de hoy, lo moderno, es el pero tú también. Y ha sucedido que ahora es pero tú más. Es decir, a una acusación de corrupción se responde con otra acusación de corrupción y entonces pretenden neutralizarse. Sí, pero tú también. Ah, pero tú más. Y todo esto de frente al ciudadano. Por eso se desacredita los procesos democráticos, que está estudiado de alguna manera, no solo en el manual, sino eventualmente Ricardo nos podrá orientar en dónde encontraremos también la necesidad de combatir la corrupción en un ambiente de equilibrio político, pero particularmente ese equilibrio se sostiene por la información a la sociedad. Los procesos, desde mi punto de vista, los procesos de fiscalización, que no son visibles, que no se transmiten con las traducciones necesarias para que la sociedad entienda de qué acuso, qué felicito, porque también en la revisión de cuentas y en la fiscalización hay que darle sentido a plantear correctamente las cuentas que son objetivas, valorarlas, y las cuentas que son correctas también hay que presentárselas a la sociedad para que haya un punto de contraste, un medio de contraste entre lo que se encuentra en la fiscalización de bueno y de malo, para tener el soporte de la sociedad, y nos estamos refiriendo a regímenes democráticos en donde el castigo, la reprimenda, la sanción, cuando muy tarde llegará en las próximas elecciones. Pero sé que no es muy satisfactorio. Yo propongo que en GOPAC también hagamos un estudio de fondo sobre cómo resolver problemas puntuales como la cobertura que dan, la complicidad o la protección que dan a los perpetradores de la corrupción, las componendas y los arreglos entre los partidos políticos para también ocultar la corrupción y señalar con toda puntualidad cuáles son los recursos disponibles y válidos para un parlamento que se enfrenta con estos problemas. No todos los medios que se emplean en la política son válidos para combatir la corrupción, porque la mentira, el chantaje, la componenda forman parte del propio proceso a través del cual se escuda la corrupción. Yo creo que tendremos que profundizar en estos estudios. No es algo que en casuística se pueda resolver para todos, pero sí creo que debemos analizar cuál es el rol particularmente de los grupos parlamentarios y los partidos políticos frente a una fiscalización efectiva.
first, Dr.
Yu. I'll just take 2 minutes, and I want to specifically refer to our Kenyan MP's questions. Number one, your questions, I, as a Malaysian Parliament MP, are very familiar with. Your problems are problems that we are also sometimes facing, number one. Number two, I think the questions you ask and the issues you raise could also have been handled through our tool, which I mentioned in my remarks, which is the anti-corruption tool for parliamentarians, where questions regarding the independence of anti-corruption agency, the role of parliamentarians are among the many questions and items that is in the tool that parliamentarians in the four countries that I mentioned went through. Maybe it is beneficial if the Kenyan MPs also go through that. The third point is that the issues that you raise also regarding the chief executive shielding and protecting corrupt political leaders are actually one of the issues that the UNCAC itself addressed. Peer group assessment and all those will highlight this and will therefore expose the weaknesses and failures of the implementation of UNCAC by a particular country like Kenya that you mentioned. The similarity that we also have between your situation and our situation in Malaysia is the voting in Parliament. I think this is the Westminster practice, where party whips, party discipline, voting along party lines are very strictly practiced and followed. And if you fail to do that, you get thrown out of your party or all those. That I think are serious issues that we need to go into further. There has been no occasion where party leaders say you are free to vote according to your conscience. No such. We follow Westminster, but at that point, I think we stop following Westminster tradition. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Those were tough questions. I answer first the question of I don't need translation for myself, from Kenya. What do you do? Well, you know, obviously, there's a variety of ways you can in which you can fight corruption. You can say, you know, we create sanctions, you know, we punish. But punishment is not enough. What you need is prevention. You need to reduce the incentives for politicians to engage in these kind of practices, because then for a variety of reasons, they might get protection from the executive and so forth and so on. They might escape punishment once they do some wrongdoing. So you want to make sure they don't even engage in corrupt practices or in illicit practices or in unethical behavior. And how do you do that? Well, I think you have to create the condition for, you have to create a demand for good governance. You know, you need to make parliamentarians understand that corruption is not sustainable. You know, it affects development, it reduces growth, reduces development, it increases infant mortality, it has a big cost. If for a developing country, that's not a luxury that you can afford. That's the line. Corruption for a developing country is an affordable luxury. And therefore, what is important is to tell parliamentarians that they have not only a moral obligation, but they have a practical obligation that if they want to take their country and make them develop, they have to fight corruption. And once parliamentarians understand that they can make a political career by fighting corruption instead of becoming corrupt, you create the proper condition for a successful anti-corruption campaign. You know, and I give you a concrete example. When we started, you know, up to 2002, when a man called a man called David McGee, who was the general secretary of the Parliament of New Zealand, wrote a book on public account committees. Nobody was paying any attention to public account committees. They had been there for centuries, since 1862, when Gladstone created this kind of public committee in the Westminster system. But for 140 years, nobody had paid any attention to these committees. And the reason was they were believed to be not terribly important. And parliamentarians didn't want to serve on these committees because they were thinking that if they had gone on a committee that was not spending money, they would have undermined their chances to be reelected. And so they said, we don't want to be in that silly committee. Mm-hmm. But over the years, it became clear that a parliamentarian that plays well its role, his role or her role in the public account committee, plays a key role in fighting corruption, gets visibility, is a champion of the people. And, you know, is the people who votes for you. And that's very important. And so, you know, a key lesson in my view, I don't know if we are ever clear when we write, because you know, no academic writes clearly by definition, but the key lesson here is, you know, you can have an important political career by becoming the champion of good governance. Eva Kuzundari in Indonesia is the champion of good governance in Indonesia. She's known in the whole world, and she wins lots of votes because of that. And you know, I think that's a lesson that, you know, that should travel. You know, that's not a success story in Indonesia. It's a success story that should be replicated elsewhere, because I think it's a great story. The other thing that I wanted to say is, well, of course, you know, that has been traditionally the problem, not just in presidential systems, but also in parliamentary systems, where a member of parliament is loyal to his party. And so if a fellow party member is rumored to be involved in some wrongdoing, you try to protect him. That's wrong. And even here, there's a very important lesson that we should all take home, which is that it is true that as a party member, you're bound to have some loyalty to your political party. But you also have an institutional loyalty. You have some loyalty that you own to your parliament as an institution, and there's a loyalty you have to have to your people. And if you protect someone who performs some wrongdoing, you're betraying the people and you're betraying the institution. And that's not acceptable. And so I think that, you know, I think there's what is really important, what I'm trying to say is that what is really important is that there has to be some kind of cultural change. You have to appreciate that, you know, you have many hats that you wear when you perform your parliamentary role. You're a representative, you're a lawmaker, but you're also an overseer. And you know, and as an overseer, your primary function is to fight corruption. So, Albania, I think you gave a very good example of what I try to say in a much less clear way, which is that once you have a poor system of government, of governance, and where you have corruption, you know, that erodes the political system and creates the condition for political instability, violence, and all kind of terrible things that are happening in your country and in other countries with similar problems. I think that here, there's only one way to go. And the only way to go is to tell your fellow parliamentarians that if there's no change in the course of action, this road only takes you to collapse and to catastrophe. So basically, you know, it's not whether they like to be honest, whether they think it's moral or just. It's not a philosophical principle. There's a very practical implication. They either agree on the fact that Albania has to change the way it works, or Albania will pay a very high price. And what's more important is that Albanian citizens will hold you accountable for that failure. So, you know, if the Albanian system suffers, it's not just a philosophical idea. You know, the system will collapse, and many fellow members of parliament will not be returned to parliament. So, since they benefit from the survival of this political system, they have to make sure that the system works in the best possible way, in the interest of the citizens, and also in their own interest. And I think that once you make sure that the interest of the population is the interest that of the parliamentarians as well, they will have a greater commitment to fighting corruption.
Well, I think we have time for three more questions. One here, but we said we would take some in the back. So we will have yours. And the lady in the red at the back. Yes? Okay. And let's have one over here. The gentleman with the red tie. So, can you lead off for me, please? Thank you.
Yes, mine is a very short one. You said earlier that...
And you'll give your name and your organization.
Yes, I beg your pardon. My name is Shakil Shabir. I'm the Member of Parliament for Kenya and the Chairman of APNAC Kenya. You said earlier on, the President, the Chair of GOPAC, said that GOPAC has now been accredited as an observer to UNCAC, or the state parties. At this moment in time, the countries are doing the self-assessments. And I was wondering, would it not be right if you as GOPAC, us as GOPAC, being accredited observers, now play a pivotal role in that assessment? Because I know for Kenya, we were never involved. Nobody even asked us. The executive have just done it quietly on one side, and we don't know anything about it, and we are now coming for an assessment. Could go back now, flex your muscles and say, until and unless the local GOPAC members or committees are involved, we wouldn't want to have it completed before then. Thank you.
Correct.
Thank you. Being in bright pink and a woman in this floor, in this forum, I think was beneficial this time. My name is Irune Aguirre-Zabal, and I'm from UN Women, which is the entity for equality of gender and the empowerment of women in the United Nations, as you know. And thank you very much for the invitation to this GOPAC meeting in Panama. I'm the regional advisor on political participation for the Americas and the Caribbean. And I'm obviously very interested in this subject you are discussing here today. Short question on women. Gender inequality is manifested in many dimensions, and also in the deficit in political participation of women and men in parliaments, and at all levels of parliament, state, regional, sub-regional, and local, as you know. Currently, in this region, which is the highest ranking in the world, there's around 25% of women in parliaments, while in the world, the average could be 21% of women in parliament. My question is, have you, in your research, encountered links between the participation of women and the fight against corruption? And this stands from the assumption that where there's a more democratic regime, there's more inclusion of all ethnias, races, groups, and obviously when there is equal representation of women and men, there's more democracy, there's more legitimacy. That's why I would be very interested to hear if you have research and you have encountered evidence that having more women in politics is also a means to better fighting against corruption. Thank you very much.